Okay, so this is a unscripted tutorial about facegroups. So if you look in the manual, you see that it mentions a few things that facegroups are for, but has this very sort of vague intro line about being able to organize your model into different colored faces. So I thought we should probably first start with what that means. So with this model, if I go back into matcap mode and turn off show painting and turn on facegroups, so by default, if I go into facegroups, and I'm even going to go down a few levels of subdivision just so we're not distracted by other things. Oh, this is the last level. Also, and I'm going to turn off the post-processing as well. So here we are, back to the vanilla model. So by default, when you go to the facegroup, you see the model changes color and not much else. If you do what I do and just like randomly start stabbing at things and you start scribbling, you'll see that you get areas of color. And if you keep painting different strokes, you get different blocks of color. So that's kind of interesting. So first of all, what can we do with this? Well, straight away, this is this becomes useful for a few different things. So I mentioned in the docs that it can be a quick selection for masks. So what does that mean? So if I get out of the face group now and go to the regular masking, you can see that by default, it still hints at the face groups being there. And so normally, if you were to mask, if you were to mask stuff, you'd be scribbling on areas and things like that. That's all fine. Gonna undo. But what you can also do now is you can just tap. And if you have face group defined, so if I turn on face group there and then tap on a face group, it now masks just that region. That's pretty handy. So even if I happen to turn off face group display in the shading menu, I can't do that. Fine. But I can now sort of select multiple bits, so I can very quickly mask off things like that. And clear all, or I can select a few things and I can invert. It's pretty handy. So why would you use this? So let's go a bit more practical example. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to get rid of these face groups. So one of many ways to do it is I could just paint. So from what you've seen already, each time that I paint, I'm going to draw a new face group. If you want to turn that off, you can use this button over here, this face group plus button. So if I turn that off, now it'll stick with basically whatever was the last selected face group. So you can see over here, you've got this this patch button, this pink one. So I can go maybe to say this this green one, which is what most of the model is using. And I could now just like quickly scribble all these other face groups away. Now that we've got all these unneeded face groups, you can get rid of the ones that you're not using by pressing this remove unused button. So now just back to a single one. So what's a more careful use for face groups? So if we go back into the auto generate, what I'll often do for faces is I'll quickly basically scribble out some areas that I might want to mask. So it's going to be basically eyes, nose, mouth, chin, ears. That's usually the pack. So I'll very quickly go, well, I might want to work on the eyes. I might want to work on the nose. And keep in mind that you don't have to be absolutely perfect first go. You can just sort of roughly indicate it, and I'll go back and fix these areas later. If I want to get the lips, this tool's a bit too big, so I'm going to reduce the scale using the slider. So I'm going to indicate where the mouth is, kind of like that. And what else would I indicate? That's probably fine for now. Next thing you want to do is fix up these regions that you didn't get properly. The other really useful feature of the facegroup paint tool, or the facegroup tool, is if I turn off the auto add, but turn on here, auto pick. So now what'll happen is wherever I start my drag, it'll pick up the facegroup there and then let me paint with it. So let's say, for example, that for this blue, and I want to fix up this area here on the nose, I can start over here on the blue, and then when I drag, it just basically continues the blue. If I go over here where I've got too much of the red here, I can start on the green, and I can just like sort of scrape it back. But if I go, well, I've got too much, well, I can start on the red, and I can paint it back with the red. So this is a really fast way to do corrections. So I might sort of tidy this up around there, get rid of that bit, get rid of that bit, paint back in the red. So you can see that you can sort of tidy up these regions pretty quickly. So now it means that when I go back into the masking tool, and if I have facegroup turned on, I can quickly choose the eye, the nose, the lips. I can invert it, and I can smooth, blur, do whatever I want. So that's part one, using it for masks. Part two, the hiding and showing, it's almost the same as the masking tools. So if I clear all, and if I use down here this hide tool over here, so if I choose that, this is also by default set to use face groups. And it's simply, if I tap on a face group, that'll be hidden. And if I want to invert, I can press the invert button, so now I'm only working on that region. So this is a tool that anyone who used ZBrush got used to really quickly, and it's fantastic to now have that inside Nomad. So if I only want to work on the nose, I can tap on the nose, go invert, now it's just the nose. Clear all, I just want to work on the lips now. Choose the lips, invert, there we are. Clear again, I want to hide the rest of the head. Tap there, that's gone. So really fast way to be able to zero in on your sculpt and work on bits and pieces in isolation. Organize your object without having to split it. So this is almost what we've done already in terms of, you know, as you're working on a head, you might be really wanting to concentrate on just the eye, just the nose, just the mouth. In the past, you might have actually split those out into separate parts in your hierarchy. So here you can see I've got this sphere is the entire head, but I've got separate things for separate spheres for the eyeballs. Sometimes in the past, I've actually split it out so that I've got separate objects for the eye region, the lip region. But now you don't have to because facegroups does a lot of that work for you, which is pretty useful. Come back to the features, defining UV regions. So let's see what this looks like. If I, again, get rid of all my face groups, I'm going to go back to face group and I'm going to reset. Yep. So now I'm back to no face groups. And if I, I'm just going to quickly decimate this down so it doesn't take too long to UV. So I'm going to go, should make a copy of this model for a sec. So I'm going to clone it, hide the original, hide everything else. So with this guy, I'm going to decimate him down. So going to go to misc and decimation, and I'm going to set it, yeah, just get by half. So I'm going to turn on wireframe, and go decimate, 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 until it looks sort of lowish res, like that. That's perfect, that's pretty good. So if I were to run a UV unwrap on that, we get this atlas. If I inspect it, you can see that it's tried to break it up as best it can. Has it done okay? It's done the best that it can do, but you can see that obviously I, as a human, wouldn't find this very easy in terms of being able to paint cleanly across the seams, or I'd probably want to keep the face region together, although it's actually kind of done that, but I'd want to sort of the ears broken off separately, the throat separately. In previous versions of Nomad, before face groups, you couldn't control that, but now you can. So if I go back in and basically do what I did before, so if I use the face group tool to paint face groups. So, and I'm gonna basically roughly tell Nomad where I want my UV seams to be. So I'm gonna say that, make sure I got, this is, because I got that turned on, yeah. So I'm going to paint a region for the ears. So this is kind of where I want a seam to be. I want a region maybe for the neck. So I'm gonna paint all this. That can be a single zone. I want the face and the nose all kind of treated as one. So I'm just going to do a quick lip like that. And I might say separate off the back of the head because why not? So I'm going to do that. I'm going to show you another handy tip that you can do here. So you can see that when I've got this auto mode turned on, it randomly chooses a new color each time. If I do auto pick, then it's this thing where I can click and drag. But what I can also do is if I turn off auto pick, whatever color I've chosen in here, so now I've got this salmon color, I can tap in any region and it will fill that region with the currently chosen thing. The other thing I can do is if I long hold, so if I press and hold, although in my case I've got to do it with my finger, press and long hold, and it'll be like an eyedropper to choose a face group. So I'm going to choose this pink region, then I'm just going to tap on the nose, and that flood fills to all of that region. You can see I've got other regions down here, so I'm just going to tidy that up. And I've got to tidy up across the back of the head here, so I'm going to choose this zone and patch up this bit. So that's now a solid zone, so I can now tap in there, that's filled. What else would I want to do? Maybe across the bottom here, I'm going to choose that and tap. So now I've got these regions. Now, if I use the UV unwrap tool, you can see that in the options here, I've got this option to use face groups. So now if I go unwrap and turn on the inspector, you can see that this has now tried to respect the those face groups which I've set up. So I've got more, I guess, controllable regions for UVing, which is pretty handy. You can be more careful, I suppose, where if you were to go the max stretch. You can turn it right up so that it doesn't try to unwarp the islands more than it should, but you can play with these numbers. So now if I go unwrap, you can see that it's definitely respected those regions more, which is pretty useful. Back to the feature list, guiding the quad measure. So this is probably one of its most useful features, assuming you've, you're on iOS and you've bought the quad remesher feature. So if I turn on facegroups again, and you can see that I've got these kind of regions, and I've got where these borders are, that will be that can be used by the quad measure to help steer the flow. So let's see what happens. So if I turn off the regions, if I go to the quad remesher, and I say don't use facegroups, and I will keep on symmetry, and we'll just see what this does. So if we go remesh, you can see that it does, you know, obviously a very good job, but it's not exactly respecting some of the borders that I would have chosen. But if I go undo and I say actually use these facegroups, you can see that it just sort of hints the shading of those facegroups in there. When I run it again, it'll use those borders to try and steer the algorithm, which is really useful. So in a more, I guess, like sort of a proper example, I go back to facegroups and I would be more careful about where I was defining my groups. I'd say, well, I want a loop around the eyes. I want a loop around the mouth. I want a loop around the nose. I'm going to turn off facegroup and turn on auto pick so I can fix up the rest of the nose there. So these are kind of more the regions that I'd want. And maybe if I were to be really careful, this is fine. Just paint that to there. So now to go back to the quad remesher and go remesh, that now defines groups that the quad measure tries to follow. Now, it doesn't always get it right, especially if I set the resolution quite low. You can see that it's got a bit confused through here, but usually just a bit of a smooth can often calm that down, and that becomes a pretty good base for your topology. And then the last use, which is quite general and quite powerful, is additional controls for certain tools. So this wording is intentionally vague because it's so wide-reaching. What this is talking about is if you have, so right now I've got the smooth tool enabled. If I turn on, in the shading menu, turn on the face groups, this will now take into account the borders between the face groups, and it will limit the effects so that it doesn't affect the borders quite so much, or it affects it in a different way. So if I start to smooth, say here, for example, you can see that it's kind of working on this border, but it's not affecting the other face group nearby. So at the moment, I'm just scribbling on this pink region, but you can see the blue region isn't affected. If I turn off the face group display, you can see that this affects everything. So this actually becomes a really powerful way to do hard surface sculpting. So if I were to subdivide this a few times, so I've got more detail there, and then go to smoothing tool, turn on my face group preview, and make my brush quite large, you can see that what will happen is it'll start to kind of smooth within the group up to the border. And especially if I turn on stable smoothing, this will start to give you this sort of very kind of hard surface look. Great for sort of kind of mech modeling and things of that nature. So you can see that now I've got these very like sort of sharply defined panel edges. One of the other things you can do with the facegroup tool is I've got this tool called Relax. And so this will sort of intentionally smooth down borders. If I undo a few steps back to where I had the this mesh, this is a better use of the tool. So if I use this Relax brush and I paint along the edge, you can see that it just tries to give me this lovely, nice, clean edge. Really, really useful. So smooth that edge. So now I've got super precise edges. Again, great for if I were to subdivide and smooth, you'd get lovely kind of like hard edge mech paneling. And quite a few of the tools can be aware of face groups. So for the most part, if you choose a tool, like say, I don't know, say the clay tool, go to the filtering options, and under filter, there'll be an option here for face group. So when it's in auto, what that means is if you are displaying face groups, it'll then try and limit and filter by face groups. But if you're not displaying face groups, it doesn't work. or you can have it always be off or always be on. So now if I draw, you can see that it behaves slightly different on the border there. So I think that covers all the major uses for face groups. There's a few other options down here. These are explained a bit more carefully in terms of like patch, I just discussed, dot relax, shape selector, and auto pick. I think that's all makes sense. But that should be most of what you need to know for face groups. If you have any other questions, leave a comment and ask on the Discord. Cheers.